you know, every one of the videos that Roger takes of our lectures begins with a shot of me leaning over at the computer and clicking the start button to import the video. I really get tired of looking at it. Nonetheless, welcome. I'd like to make a couple of announcements before we get started. We have a lecture next week, next Thursday, May 13th. Professor James Russell from Harvard University will be giving a talk entitled Magic from Greater Iran, the Parthian-Armenian-Russian Triangle. This lecture will be given in honor of the 90th birthday of Professor Richard N. Fry, NAASR founding member and Aga Khan Professor Emeritus of Iranian Studies at Harvard University. And Professor Fry will be here the night of the lecture it's not his actual birthday, but nonetheless, we'll pretend that it is. On Saturday, May 15th, will be our 56th annual assembly of members. And if you are a NAASR member and plan to attend, and we hope you do, please register, talk to Kathy. There are these around, which you can use for that very purpose. And on Thursday, May 20th, in 2 weeks, we will have a talk by Dr. Vahram Shamassian from Cal State Northridge, entitled Humanitarian Intervention by the Armenian Prelacy of Aleppo During the First Months of the Genocide. And that will be, again, here on Thursday, May 20th. So that's what the next few weeks hold for us, and programs will be continuing, I have every reason to believe, on past that into May and June and July and so forth. As most of you who are here tonight know already, and if you don't, then you can read, this evening's lecture is being given in honor of Dr. Moorad Mooradian. And before I turn things over to our speaker tonight, Professor Bournoutian, I'd like to just say a few words about Moorad on behalf of NAASR and the board and myself. Moorad passed away last September, unfortunately, at age 73, and I would like to acknowledge the presence here tonight of Moorad's wife, Lillian Mooradian, their daughter, Natalie Mooradian Hogan, and Moorad's sisters, Anna Boyajian and Beatrice Petricone. Could I ask you just to briefly stand, wave, and be acknowledged? Thank you. Moorad served on NAASR's board of directors from 1991 to 2004. And moreover, he gave a number of noteworthy lectures and presentations here at NAASR in the 1990s and 2000s, most of them focusing on contemporary Armenian politics and foreign policy, and with a particular focus on Nagorno-Karabakh, the conflict, and then the unresolved situation in Nagorno-Karabakh. Of course, Moorad was deeply involved in Armenian affairs beyond his involvement with NAASR. And in addition to serving on NAASR's board, he was a longtime dedicated board member of the Armenia Tree Project. And he was probably most widely known to the whole Armenian American community for his column that he wrote for so many years in the Armenian Mirror Spectator, and which appeared elsewhere as well. How many years did he write the column?
Probably 15 at least.
15 years or more, yeah. It was very widely read, no question about it. Moorad was the son of survivors of the Armenian Genocide, and he was raised in Providence. He received a PhD from the Institute for Conflict Analysis and Resolution at George Mason University after a distinguished 30-year career in the U.S. Army, from which he retired as a colonel. He served in Vietnam and was the recipient of numerous decorations and awards, including a Purple Heart. He tells the story of his military service in the book The Faces of Courage, Armenian World War II, Korea, and Vietnam Heroes by Richard Demergent. It's quite an interesting story. Moorad was professor of history and international relations at the West Point U.S. Military Academy in New York, and he began teaching at Yerevan State University in 1995 and helped establish the conflict studies curriculum there, which was the first of its kind in the former Soviet Union. He also served as an unofficial advisor to the Minister of Foreign Affairs in Armenia and was four times a Fulbright Scholar in Armenia. It would be presumptuous for me to speak intimately of Moorad because I know there are people here tonight who knew him very well, but I had the pleasure of getting to know Moorad after I began working at NAASR in 1998. And I was grateful and will always be grateful for the support and the encouragement he gave me in the early days here at NAASR, and as my own role at NAASR evolved, he was always very supportive. I certainly enjoyed the lectures he gave here, which were always well attended, and his booming voice. He didn't need a microphone, but his booming voice reached the audience in more ways than one. Like so many in the community, of course, I read Moorad's column in the newspapers, and like any good columnist, sometimes you agreed with him, and sometimes you didn't. But you knew with Moorad that whatever he was writing, he was leveling with you, he was telling the truth the way he saw it, and though he wasn't an ideologue or a nationalist, I wouldn't say, he was definitely a patriot, an Armenian one, an American one, as well as an Armenian-American one. So he definitely left his mark, and his voice and his presence is very much missed. So we're very pleased, really, to be honoring him tonight. As I said before, one of Moorad's abiding interests definitely was in Nagorno-Karabakh. And in this respect, he is linked with our speaker tonight, Professor George Bournoutian. So it seemed very appropriate to hold this lecture tonight in Moorad's honor. Even though the two approach Karabakh from definitely different angles, Moorad mostly from the perspective of contemporary politics and military strategy and foreign affairs, Professor Bournoutian as a historian dealing mainly with the 18th, early 19th century. But as we know, in that part of the world, the history of several centuries ago and contemporary politics do not exactly dwell far apart. And among Professor Bournoutian's many other projects, he has devoted considerable time and energy over the past couple of decades to providing scholarly and accurate documentation of the Armenian presence in Karabakh, and to counter attempts to falsify that history, to corrupt primary sources, to efface Armenians from the history of the region altogether. Professor Bournoutian's recent translation, with extensive notes and commentary, of Isai Hassan Jalalian's Brief History of the Akhonk Region, which was written in the early part of the 18th century, adds to such earlier works as two chronicles on the history of Karabakh and numerous articles exposing the outright falsification of the history of the region in Azeri official publications. Professor Bournoutian is also the author or translator of numerous other books, including, but not limited to, A Concise History of the Armenian People, Eastern Armenia in the Last Decades of Persian Rule, The Travel Accounts of Simeon of Poland, Tigran II in Rome, and Jamber. He is Senior Professor of History at Iona College and has taught Armenian history at Columbia, Tufts University, NYU, Rutgers, and elsewhere. And lastly, I would be extremely remiss if I didn't take note and remind everyone that Professor Bournoutian has immeasurably enriched NAASR by giving his extraordinary library of approximately 3,000 volumes to us, which is up above some of your heads, in creating what is now and what will forever be known as the Ani and George Bournoutian Collection. The library has been in the building for about a year and a half, and as of this spring, it is fully cataloged, thanks to the efforts of Peripsime Mukherjian and Lindai Tablian, primarily, who are here. And Professor Bournoutian even provided an assist today by helping with some of the few remaining volumes that we had trouble locating in catalogs. So not only did he give the collection, but he also helped catalog it. It's an incredible library and one which we hope and believe will benefit researchers for years to come. So without further words, please welcome Professor George Bournoutian.
You do? Yeah. Sure.
You don't have to talk right into them, but just bring them down.
Yeah, I'm not used to microphones.
Because I scream all the time in the classroom. It is indeed an honor for me to give a lecture in memory of my dear friend Moorad. We did not meet often, but we corresponded and emailed each other frequently. Because I read his articles, although, as Mark said, I'm a historian. I do not deal with present-day conflicts in Karabakh, but like every Armenian, I follow it, obviously. And Murad's insightful articles, truly patriotic, not nationalistic, extremely dedicated Armenian, always made my day. I get the Mirror Spectator. It's one of the few journals I do. And the first thing I opened was always Murad's article. So I'm sorry he is gone, but maybe he's watching us from a better place. Now, today's lecture has to do with falsification, attempts of falsification of Azeris regarding Armenian history. Following the demands of the Karabakh Armenians to secede from Azerbaijan and join Armenia, a number of Azeri academics, led by the famous, now dead, academician Ziya Bunyatov, in order to justify their government's claims regarding Karabakh, rushed to prove that the Armenian population of Karabakh had only arrived there after 1828, that is, after the Treaty of Turkmenchay following the Second Russo-Iranian War. Therefore, the Armenians had no historical claim to the region. Lacking any sources written in Azeri, since the Azeri alphabet was created in the 20th century, and refusing for obvious reasons to cite Armenian sources, these Azeri academics I would put in quotes because they don't deserve the title, they had to rely on sources written in Persian, Arabic, and Russian, among others. To their horrible surprise, they found that not only had ancient and medieval Greek, Roman, Arab, Persian, as well as early modern Russian, German, and English historians, geographers, travelers, placed Karabakh in historic Armenia, but that the Armenians had formed a large part of the population of Karabakh centuries prior to 1828. I will give you a number of material that they found and they couldn't use. Ptolemy's geography, Strabon's or Strabo's geography, Diocasius's Roman history, Mostofi's Kitab Nuzhat al-Qulub, Estakhri's Masalik wa Mamalik, Khordazbe's Al-Masalik wa Al-Mamalik, Yaqubi's Tarikh, Muqaddas's Ahsan al-Taqasim, Ibn Hawqal's Kitab Surat al-Arz, Balathuri's Fatuh al-Buldan, Hudud al-Alam. All of these books are upstairs, by the way. Minorsky's translation of Jamiel Duwal and Baba Abvab in his history of Sharwan and Darban. Keppel's personal narrative of a journey to India and England, and Romer's Taimur Elang in Persia in Cambridge History of Iran, Volume 6. These are just a few of the material by non-Armenian sources, all of whom mentioned that Karabakh was part of historic Armenia and there was a large Armenian presence in the region prior to 1828. Even more surprising was the fact that Muslim historians living on the territory of what later became the Azerbaijan Republic, their own historians, these are Turkic, or at that time there was no such thing as Azeri, these are known as Turko-Tatars. The Turko-Tatar historians like Baki Khanov, Mirza Jamal Javanshir, Mirza Adi Gözalbey, the first one of whom was honored by the Academy of Sciences in Baku as the father of the history of Azerbaijan, all three had clearly indicated a strong Armenian presence in Karabakh prior to 1828 and had placed the region within the territory of historic Armenia. These were historians that wrote in the 19th century, before there was any Azerbaijan. Okay? All of these manuscripts are available. They had been translated into Russian and Azeri. Abbas Koli Agha, Bakikhanov, Gulistani Yeram, Baku, 1926. Azeri version published Baku, 1951. Mirza Javanshir, History of Karabakh, Baku, 1959, Azeri version, published the same year, Ali Gözalbek, Karabakh Nama, Baku, 1950, the first being translated only in Russian, this edition. Now, Bakihanov's was has been translated into English by Willem Flohr. The others have been translated into English in the two Chronicles of Karabakh by myself. What the Azeris realized, to their horror, that this is what was happening, in 1988, they took this, their own editions, their own Russian editions, their own Azeri editions, which were published in the 1950s, in very, very small numbers. They reprinted them. Reprinted them in thousands of volumes and sent it free of charge to the United States and Europe to all the libraries. Okay. This is our major problem that we have, is that the Republic of Armenia doesn't have any money to do that, and the Armenian diaspora, I mean, I'm not trying to say you have to give money, not to me, but to scholars who are translating and scholars who are trying to do this kind of work. The Azeri government is behind their work, and they are sponsoring these scholars and printing these books, these falsified books. And I have, in another article, I've showed exactly what they have done. The 1950 edition, it would say, for example, the Armenian Meliks of Karabakh, or the five Armenian Meliks of Karabakh. In the new edition, the word Armenian is removed completely. In the German traveler who came during the time of Tamerlane, this is long, you're talking about 1400s, came to the area of Karabakh. His chapter 14 has 32 pages on the Armenians of Karabakh. There was a Russian translation in 1800s. There's an English translation. When Baku finally printed it in 1991, the entire chapter 28 is missing. Okay? This doesn't exist. So these are the kind of material, they're printing them in thousands of copies. So, in order to substantiate their political claim, Bournoutian and his fellow academics, as I already mentioned, chose to reprint them, removing the things about Armenia. The first act, the first book of this historical disinformation began with Bournoutian's edition of Yesai's, of this book. Yesai Hasan Jalalian's Brief History. In the summer of 1988, immediately following the Armenian demonstrations, the History Institute of the Academy of Sciences of Azerbaijan prepared the printing of an unpublished Russian translation as well as an Azeri version. The following is from Bunyatov's introduction to the Azeri and the Russian versions, which were printed in 6,000 copies each. In 1978, this is his introduction, the village of Maragha or Maragashen, present-day Leninavan, in the Martakert district of Nagorno-Karabagh, an obelisk was erected in honor of the 150th anniversary of the immigration of the first 200 Armenian families from the town of Maragha in Iran into the territory of Karabakh. The immigration began immediately following the conclusion of the Treaty of Turkmenchay between Russia and Iran in 1828. He continues, no one could imagine what unpredictable event the immigration of a small numbers of Armenia into the territory of Karabakh would unleash in the future. However, even then, scholars like Velichko, diplomats like Gribayedov, Suvorov, Shavarov, Chavchavates, and many others warned the Russian government about the danger that this thoughtless decision would bring to the indigenous Azerbaijani inhabitants. First, those people he mentioned, I have all their works. They never said anything in their works against this Armenians coming. Second, even if they had said that, no way they could have said this thoughtless decision would bring to the indigenous Azerbaijani inhabitants. There was no such word as Azerbaijan in the beginning of the 19th century. There was no such place. The only Azerbaijan that existed was in Iran, the Iranian province of Azerbaijan, which is still there. But that not this Azerbaijan. There was no such thing as Azerbaijan. It was known as a Muslim province, at first, and then it had all sorts of other, the Caspian province, but it was not Azerbaijan, it was divided into different principalities and different provinces. He continues, the immigrants, subsidized by the Armenian Catholicos, immediately began to purchase lands from the local, again, Azerbaijani Khans, and very soon a huge mass of Armenians, thousands of families, immigrated to Karabakh. First, the Catholicos did not give any money to this immigration. We have it as a fact. The immigration was financed by the Russian government, 14,000 gold rubles and 400 silver rubles were spent to relocate approximately 40,000 individuals, and I'll tell you where those 40,000 went, and I have the source, which we will go more in detail. To legitimize this addition, this new addition that Bournoutian, as unbiased, Bournoutian stated that the translator who translated this from the original Grapar into Russian, then Bournoutian translated it from Russian into Azeri, was an Armenian by the name of Tigran Ter Grigoryan, an Armenian scholar working at the History Institute of Baku. As you know, Baku had a large Armenian community. He had prepared the Russian translation, from which Bournoutian prepared the Azeri translation. Okay? His translation from the original Armenian was completed in 1940, almost 50 years before. But for some unexplained reason, Bournoutian never explains, it was not published and had remained in the archives of the Institute. Now, half a century later, Bournoutian had decided to publish this work in Russian and then in Azeri. In comparing the original Armenian with Bunyatov's edition, okay, and I have the original Armenian text right there, it becomes evident that either Ter Grigoryan anticipated the current arguments over Karabakh 50 years before they started and sought to substantiate Azeri claims, or, as I think is more likely, Bournoutian, whose alteration of texts has been previously documented, edited parts of Ter Grigoryan's translation. Since Ter Grigoryan is no longer alive to verify what was supposedly his translation and introduction, we must assume that the late Professor Bournoutian once again deliberately altered a primary source to suit the aims of the state. Such acts were common during the reign of Stalin, but are truly reprehensible in our days. Now, Bournoutian continues his misinformation by referring to the author as Hassan Jalal, rather than his Armenian surname, as it appears in the original, Hassan Jalal Yants. He also referred to him as an Albanian, whose ancestors were the famed Albanian Mukhranid princes. Furthermore, his title, the Russian and Azeri title, is A Short History of the Country of Caucasian Albania. And his substitution of the term Albanian for Armenian in key passages, okay, as well as the deletion of Esai's introduction and his Christian statements, because Isaiah has a lot of statements for Christ, the Virgin Mary, etc., all deleted, make it appear that the population referred to in the text was not Armenian or even Christian, but science of Caucasian Albanians, and then Hassan Jalal's history is about Caucasian Albania, not the Armenian districts of Karabakh and Ganja. His introduction also asserts that the Catholicosate of Ahvank in Ganzasar was not only totally independent from Echmiadzin, but was Armenian, Albanian, and not Armenian. He accuses the Armenian Catholicos at Echmiadzin of liquidating the Albanian see by bribing the Holy Synod in St. Petersburg in 1837, by taking over all the income of the diocese of this area of Albania and forcing the Georgian Armenian faith upon the ancestor of the Albanians, part of whom had accepted Islam as is evident in the double Azeri-Armenian names such as Melik Abbas, Melik Shahnazar, Melik Yeganyan, Melik Aghajan, Melik Aghalar, Melik Aslan, Melik Pasha, and so forth. Furthermore, in order to create the office of Catholicos of all Armenians, they had to terminate the Catholicosate of Akhtamar, Sis, Ganzasar, and then he goes on to lament the fate of poor Armenian Catholics, Armenian Jews, I don't know what Armenian Jews are, and Armenian Gypsies, which have been left out by this nasty Armenian Catholicosate. Totally irrelevant, everything he's saying here, but that's all right. Now, what I've done is, I've gone point by point to refute Bunyatov's assertions on this volume, the Russian and the Azeri version. First, Yesai was not Albanian. In his own preface of this book, which is not included in the Bunyatov edition, the preface is not included, Yesai clearly identifies himself as an Armenian. His family was descended from the Armenian general Hasan Jalal Doule, an ally of the prominent 10th century Armenian Artsaruni clan. 3 centuries later, members of that family married into the Zakharian Armenian family of Georgia. The Zakharid general Sarkis and his sons Zakhare and Ioane served as commanders-in-chief and court counselor in the service of Queen Tamar of Georgia. A member of the Armenian-Georgian Bagratid dynasty, this family was. A daughter of Sarkis, Khorishan, married Vakhtang, the Aran Shah prince of Khachen in Karabakh. They were not therefore Albanian, but Armenian. Following the Mongol invasion of Georgia, more members of this family settled in the highlands of Khachen, Karabakh, where a family patriarch had built the great Armenian cathedral of Ganzasar, which is still there. The Armenians of the region would not have elected a non-Armenian as their Catholicos, nor would have been he would have been accepted by Echmiadzin. Second, Yesai's title of his brief history in Armenian is Padmutyun Hamarot Aghvanits Yergri. The Armenian term Yergir has many meanings: land, country, region, territory, earth, district, province, etc. Yesai's narrative concerns the conditions of the Armenian population of the various districts in Karabakh, Ganja, and Shirvan, that is the Armenian diocese under the jurisdiction of the See of Ganzasar during the difficult times of the decline and fall of the Safavid kingdom and the Lezgin attacks on Karabakh and Ganja. The term Yergir, as used by Yesai, therefore does not translate as country, but as region and districts. This is made clear, it's not my interpretation, this is made clear by a decree of the Persian Shah Sultan Hussein, who at the end of 1701 confirms Yesai as the Catholicos. His decree does not mention the country of Aghvang, but states the following: at this time, Catholicos Yesai, the best among dignitaries, has informed us that the Catholicosate of the Armenians living in the districts of Ganja, Karabakh, and Shirvan, which previously was run by his paternal uncle, was claimed after his uncle's death by Yesai. And so the Armenians of these places have given their consent to Yesai to become their Catholicos, and therefore he has presented us, the Shah, with a document sealed by the local Sheikhul Islam of Karabakh, the Muslim religious head, and signed by a group of Armenian and non-Armenian witnesses. He has asked us to grant the above-mentioned post of Catholicos to him. So you see, right there, it clearly indicates that it's not the country of Albania, but it's mainly Karabakh and Ganja. Third section. Bunyatov implies that after the initial 200 Armenian families, a flood of Armenian immigrants arrived in Karabakh from Iran. after the Treaty of Turkmenchay, 1828. What he fails to tell us is that the above 200 Armenian families, which is barely 1,000 people, were the only Armenian immigrants from Iran that came into Karabakh. Nowhere, no more. And I have the facts here, I have all the numbers. This fact is noted by the Russian author Sergei Glinka, who published the statistics which were based on the reports of the Russian officials on the scene right after the immigration. Glinka records that approximately 40,000 Armenians crossed the Araks River from Iran into Russia after 1828. Now, since only 1,000 people had gone to Karabakh, where did the rest of these 40,000 settle? Very simple. Bunyatov doesn't talk about it. He says all of them came to Karabakh. Absolutely not. According to another Russian survey in Yerevan and Nakhchivan, documented by Ivan Chopin in 1832, 3-4 years after Turkmenchay, very simple, official Russian count of the Armenian population shows that Armenian immigrants, majority of them, went to Yerevan, Nakhchivan, and the district of Ordubad, south of Nakhchivan. The survey has the following number of Armenian immigrants from Iran. 23,568, I mean this is precise, came to Yerevan region. 10,652 to the Nakhchivan area. And 1,340 to the district of Ordubad, for a total of 35,560. If one subtracts this number for the approximately 40,000 mentioned by Glinka, a little over 4,000 Armenians crossed the Araks into Zangezur and Karabakh. 3,000 of them settled in southern Zangezur in the Mehri Kapan area, and 1,000, those 200 families, went to Karabakh and established themselves in the village of Maragashen or Maraga that he is talking so much. It's amazing indeed that Bunyatov and all his colleagues have managed to ignore such primary sources written by non-Armenians and available in the main library in Baku long before the current debate over Karabakh. It was all there. The books are there. They are available. Furthermore, Bunyatov chose to ignore Yesai's text, their own text that is translated, which clearly states that in 1722, there was a 10,000-man Armenian army ready in Karabakh to join the Russian army of Peter the Great. If the Armenians of Karabakh arrived only in 1828, how come they had a 10,000 army in 1722, 100 years before? And that's in the text, and the idiot has left it in there. I mean, I would have at least taken that out. I mean, first he says there were no Armenians, then he says in 1722 there were a 10,000-man Armenian army. In addition, Bunyatov and his followers have never bothered to examine the 1823 survey, and this is very important. This is what I hope to do one day. In 1823, 5 years before Turkmenchay, Russians conducted a detailed survey in Karabakh, survey of every village. If this village was Turko-Tatar, there was no such word as Azeri, village was Armenian, how many men, how many women, what taxes each village paid to the different officials before the Russians came. That survey, which I have the original copy, that survey indicates a large Armenian population in every district of Karabakh 5 years before Turkmenchay. That survey has never been translated into English. It's a very rare document. There were only about 5 or 6 of them. I have a copy of the original, Xerox, of course, of the original. And 2 years ago, the Azeris have published it, republished it. And I'm going to check to see what have they changed between that and their translation. In addition, the numerous Persian decrees from the Persian kings and governors dating from 1462 to 1748, which I have, regarding the Armenians of Karabakh, clearly indicate the presence of a significant number of Armenians 400 years before 1828. Fourth, at no time did the hierarchy of Gansasar deviated or broke away from the Armenian mass or the Armenian church traditions established by Echmiadzin from ancient times. Unlike the Georgians, who separated from the Armenians in 609, the Armenians of Aghvank, Gansasar, Karabakh, etc., Ganja, retained the Armenian language, the Armenian church traditions, and the religion traditions from the beginning to the present. The main source on the Caucasian Albanians, the so-called Caucasian Albanians, is in Armenia, Padmuchun Aghvanits, by the Armenian historian Mofses Tashhurantsi. No other person has written. There is no Azeri source, there is no Muslim source on it. Okay? Armenians living in Georgia and Caucasian Albania believe, and constantly in all their writings, that in the beginning of the 4th century, St. Gregory established Christianity as the main faith of the Armenians, Georgians, and Caucasian Albanians. He baptized the Armenian king Terdat and the king of the Albanians by the name of Urnayr, and with their help converted the entire population of Armenia and Caucasian Albania. At the request of King Urnayr, Gregory the Illuminator sent his grandson, Grigoris, as the Katholikos of Caucasian Albania. From then on, Christian Armenian faith spread throughout Armenia, Caucasian Albania, and Georgia. All the regulations were established by St. Gregory. Georgians decided to split in 609, but Caucasian Albanian bishops and patriarchs had to obey the rule of Echmiadzin. St. Gregory consecrated his grandson, dispatched him to Caucasian Albania as the Catholicos of Caucasian Albania. After that, all the way to the end, and we have the documentation in Jambar and many other sources, every Catholicos of Gansasar had to be accepted and had to be blessed by the Catholicos at Echmiadzin. He had to travel to Echmiadzin after he was elected in Gansasar and get approval from the Holy See of Echmiadzin. Now, it is true that at times there were arguments between Echmiadzin and Gansasar, but the arguments did not involve the doctrine of the Armenian Church or the primacy of Echmiadzin. Rather, they centered on two issues. First, collection of church dues. It's always money. It still goes on to this day. Concerned the collection of church dues owed to Echmiadzin. As noted, from the early 18th century until 1768, Gansasar took over Echmiadzin's right to correct money in Russia. Echmiadzin had a rough time. The Catholicos had died. 16 months there was no Catholicos in Echmiadzin, and Yesari Jalalyan, the same man who wrote this, was responsible to immediately taking over the money from Russia. Realizing Echmiadzin has no Catholicos, Yesari sent his own prelate, a bishop, to Moscow and said, I am the Catholicos of the Armenians, I am the successor of St. Gregory. Because Echmiadzin didn't have anybody there. By the time Echmiadzin, 16 months later, had a Catholicos and sent a new prelate to Russia, the prelate from Gansasar was already there. And unfortunately, this is a bad time, but we have to acknowledge certain things that our bishops and our church leaders do. The bishop from Gansasar immediately went to the Russians and said, the prelate from Echmiadzin is a Persian spy. They arrested him. They put him in a jail in Kazan, and the prelate from Echmiadzin died in jail. For the next 60 years, until Catherine the Great became Empress of Russia, for the next 60 years, Echmiadzin could not collect a penny from the rich Armenian diocese of Russia. The money went to this man who's the one who started it. But it had nothing to do with church, anything to do with doctrine or anything else. So that's very interesting to see this. Fifth, there was no conspiracy on the part of Echmiadzin to destroy the See of Gansasar. The decline of Gansasar started when the Muslim Khan of Karabakh, He didn't control all of Karabakh, but the lowlands of Karabakh. Ibrahim Khan began to increase his attacks on the Armenian miliks. I have that in my history, the one that you have, the one that's out of print. All the material is in this. Some of it has been republished, but this is the original material. Khan, Ibrahim Khan, increased his attacks on the Armenian miliks of Karabakh. His aggressive policy forced the miliks to look once again to Russia, as they had done during the time of Peter the Great. They and the Katolikos, another Hasan Jalalian, Hovhannes Hasan Jalalian, from the same family, asked Catherine the Great to help them. Ibrahim killed a large number of the miliks, arrested Hovhannes in 1786, and murdered him in jail in 1788. Following him, Bishop Sarkis Hasan Jalalian, a relative of Hovhannes Hasan Jalalian who was killed, flees to Ganja and seeks the protection of Javad Khan of Ganja. The Ganjasar Sea remains empty for some time and was looted by Ibrahim Khan. In 1792, Sarkis was named Katolikos of Ganjasar, both by Echmiadzin and by a decree of Javad Khan of Ganja. In 1794, Ibrahim found a phony Katolikos for himself because our Sarkis had escaped. Echmiadzin did not accept this Katolikos that was elected by this Ibrahim Khan and continued to accept only Sarkis Hasan Jalalian, who had sought refuge in Akhbat and Sanahim in that time. Following the Russian conquest of Karabakh in 1805, the death of Ibrahim Khan in 1806, and the death of that phony Katolikos in 1810, Sarkis returns to Karabakh in 1808 as the Katolikos. He spends 4 years restoring Ganjasar, reclaiming all the looted Bibles and looted utensils of the church from the various Muslim chiefs. In 1815, the Katolikosate of Ganjasar is dissolved by the Russians. Sarkis is given the title of Metropolitan, and the diocese becomes a bishopric. After he dies in 1828, at the request of the Miliks and the Armenians of Karabakh, his relative, Baghdasar Hasan Jalalian, is named the Metropolitan of the Armenians of Ganja and Karabakh. Metropolitan. There's no more a Katolikosate. After 1836, the entire structure of the Armenian Church in Russia is changed. The Armenian Church is recognized as a separate entity with its own degree of autonomy, which was denied the Georgian Church. This is the famous Russian Polozhenie, or Statutes of 1836. Church property remained secure and remained tax-exempt, all Armenian church property, until we have the problem of 1905-1907. For a short time, Armenian church property is confiscated. Armenians react very heavily, but it was returned to the Armenians until the communist revolution. Once the communists take over the Armenian church, which had 23 villages in the area of Yerevan alone, and 6,000 acres of orchards and vineyards, etc., they lose it all. So, sixth, according to Mirza Jamal, Mirza Ali Gozal Beg, and every Russian source, the miliks mentioned by Bunyatov, that he says these are Muslim miliks, they have Muslim names, were Armenians, they were not Muslims. Jahanshah Karakoyunlu, the very early ruler of that area in the mid-15th century, had re-established, we have the documents, the local Armenian princes who were dispossessed by Tamerlane. He had granted them hereditary rights and privileges. These privileges continued under the Safavids, under Nader Shah, under Karim Khan Azam. It continued all the way to the end of 1700s. So, until the Russians took over the region, basically, in 1805. The main miliks were the Hasan Jalalians of Khachen, the Avanians of Dizak, the Beglarians of Gulistan, the Shahnazarians of Baranda, the Ulubekians of Geran,
the Jahanshahs of Tsar, Israelians of Jurabir, and many others in Sunik, etc., etc. There were about 40 minor Armenian gentry landlords, some of them called Meliks, some were called Tanuters, who were descended from this nobility. They were in Yerevan, Mehri, Nuhi, Khapan, Yanja, Khoi, etc., etc., etc. It was common for some Armenians, especially those in the service of Persia, to adopt Persian names, as they later adopted Russian-style surnames. If one accepts Bunyatov's argument that the names indicate that they are Muslim, then his own name, which has a Russian suffix, Bunyatov, must indicate that he was not a Muslim, but belonged to the Russian Orthodox Church, if you follow this stupid argument. Seventh, the countless Armenian churches. We have a book that just arrived, printed in 2010, Nagorno-Karabagh outside there. The countless Armenian churches, other architectural monuments found in Karabakh, all of which date back hundreds of years before 1828, totally refute Bunyatov's assertions. I mean, what are all those churches doing? Of course, some of the new Azeris are saying those churches are really not Armenian, they're Albanian churches, although they have more Armenian writings in it. Finally, despite Azeri claims, the so-called Caucasian Albanians are not the ancestors of the present-day Azeris. The various Turkic groups arrived in the regions centuries after the ancient Caucasian Albanians had either converted to Christianity and had adopted the Armenian alphabet, or had been absorbed first by the Zoroastrian Persians and then by the Arab invaders and had converted to Islam. In addition, according to all ancient sources, the land of the so-called Caucasian Albanians was situated on the right bank, northeast of the Kur River, while that of Armenia was on the left bank, southwest, and included Artsakh, which is Karabakh, Utik, which is Ganje. The Azeri claims are analogous to those of modern-day Turks, who claim that the Hittites are their ancestors. The Soviets encouraged this notion among the Turkic and Muslim groups living in Azerbaijan and Central Asia, Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, etc., just like Mustafa Kemal did in the Turkish Republic. The Soviets created new alphabets for these people, so they would not use the Arabic or Persian alphabets. This was done on purpose. Numerous Arabic and Persian words, which still form a large part of modern Turkish and modern Azeri terminology, all were given Turkish variants, Turkish suffixes, and presented to the world as Turkish or Azeri. Okay? This was done to distance the Turkic groups from Islam, as well as to instill in them the pride in a glorious, fictional, unfortunately, national identity by claiming either the Persian or Byzantine heritage as their own. Hence, the great Iranian poet Nezamiye Ganjavi became the national poet of Azerbaijan. They have a statue to this guy. He never wrote anything but in Persian. The medieval Persian poets and thinkers of Central Asia, such as Rudaki, became the national poet and philosophers of Uzbekistan. And Rumi was transformed into the great Turkish mystic poet. And even to this day, if you go to Turkey, and I was there just last September, and I used to go to Azerbaijan in the old days before all this trouble, they really will argue with you when you say, but this is not a Turkish word, it's an Arabic word, it's right there. Prove, no, it's a Turkish word. It has a Turkish suffix. Okay, kitab becomes kitablar. They add lar, kitablar, which means books, or of books, or for books, or by books. So it's lar is Arabic, but the kitab is kitab. Kitab is Arabic and Persian, which means book. Okay, kitab khane. They still call it kitab khane, but they take the kh away. In Turkish, it's kitab hana, hana. Kh is become h, and you can argue with him until doomsday. You'll say it's a Turkish word. I say, but look, kitab is Arabic, khane is Persian. It means library, house of books. No, it's Turkish. So this has been a major, major problem. In preparing this volume, I have used the 1868 edition, have examined all the other editions, the modern, the old ones, the Azeri, the Russian, and in addition to my own notes and explanation, I have made use of all the other notes and introductory material in the French, Georgian, Russian, etc. sources. All the explanations that you see in the text that appear in parentheses or brackets are my explanations, and therefore I am purposely put it in brackets so you will know that it was mine. The main goal of this book was to prepare a translation that was readable and useful without sacrificing the flavor. It is also hoped that this first English translation will make Yesai's uncut, uncensored, brief history of Karabagh and Ganja accessible to a wider scholarly audience, so students will realize that Armenians were there long before 1828. Thank you.
Questions, problems. Yes, sir. What happened to the Caucasian Albanians? Did they have a language? What happened to that language? There's nothing written. There is
a whole debate on this, which is not my field. Some people even say that that's why some people call them the so-called Caucasian Albanians. Nobody, the only history book of the Caucasian Albanians was written by an Armenian. And the book is available upstairs in both our English. It was translated by Professor Dowsett of Oxford University.
There was a New York Times reporter, Friedman, I think, journey, and he mentions going into a village in northeast of the Bur River where supposedly they spoke or had remnants of this tribe.
Well, a scholar in, who is that man who is in Georgia that's doing the...
Alexidze?
No, not Alexidze, the other person who is going against Alexidze.
Oh, yeah.
Well, we were discussing this today. There are two, there's a Georgian scholar that claims that there was such a, but there's an Armenian scholar, no, a Russian, Muravyov. A Russian scholar, Muravyov, who says that Caucasian Albanian and the Georgian alphabet was created by Mesrop Mashtots, something that those they don't recognize at all to this day.
But there is nothing left of that alphabet.
Apparently, Muravyov said there are some things. Again, it's not my field because that's philology. That's linguistics. I don't deal with linguistics.
Okay, one other thing that's probably also linguistics is Albank, the word Albank, is or an Albania. Both those words seem to be derived from the same root.
Yes, but in this book, what he means by Arvank, he means the diocese of Arvank, which is Ganzasar, which controls the diocese of what in Armenian, but the diocese he's talking about is south of the Kur River. It's not the other side of the river. It's not what we called the, what some historians refer to the old Caucasian Albanian, okay, whatever it was, that was north of the Kur River.
But there is a correlation.
There is a correlation. And Bunyatov is using that by saying he wrote History of Albania. He didn't write History of Albania. If the history is from 1702 to 1723. What Albania in 1702, 1723? There was no reason for him to write the History of Albania. There already was a History of Armenia by Movses Tashkuraneci. So this was obviously just that Arvank region which was under his diocese, his supervision, the supervision of that place. Right. Yes?
Thank you for your excellent lecture. I'm Dr. Simons from Los Angeles. Hear your lecture. Three questions. Why did the Armenians leave Persia? Why did they settle in this place? And when did they first settle there? Of course, the river helped. But who
you mean Karabagh?
Yes.
But there were only 200 Armenians that left Persia, 200 Armenian families, 1,000 people settled in Marave. The rest of them settled in Yerevan and Nakhchivan. They did not settle in Karabagh. Karabagh already had an Armenian population.
How did that happen?
Oh, that happened at the time of long before. There were a number of Armenian princes who were there before the Mongols during that interregnum when Armenian kingdom fell and Armenian nobility went to Georgia. And from Georgia, some of them moved into that area. But that was a long time ago. That was in the 1100s, 1200s. Armenians were already there. So, a long time ago. Before that, we have no record. We have no record before 1150s of a large number of Armenians. They might have been there, but there is no record. Now, what could the question is, sorry, your question is, why did the Armenians move from Iran?
Yes.
That was part of the agreement in the Treaty of Turkmenchay. In 1604, Shah Abbas brought 200,000 Armenians by force into Iran. It's that great Surgun, that great immigration, Yerguai Razar. He brought them by force from Yerevan, Van, Nakhchivan, that entire plain of Ararat to Iran. Some, most of them went to Isfahan, and most of them went to Jufa. But a large number of them stayed around the area of Tabriz, Maraghel, Khoy, Marand, that area where Saint Tadei is. That area. After the Treaty of Turkmenchay, Gribayedov and Nerses of Ashtarak pushed the Russians to put the Armenian case in the Treaty of Turkmenchay, Article 14. Article 14 states that any Christian, they don't say Armenian, but there were only Armenians there in that area, any Christian who wants to go back, who wants to go across the Arax River, north of the Arax, has 1 year, 1 year, to liquidate all his assets. Obviously, you know, they cannot carry their houses or their land. And move across. And any Muslim who wants to come south of the Arabs from Yerevan, etc. So, 40,000 Armenians, all Armenians, went from Iran, 1,000 of them to Karabakh, 39,000 of them to Yerevan, Nakhchivan, and Mehri, Kapan area. 42,000 Muslims immigrated to Iran. So it was a population exchange, very much like what happened in India and Pakistan in 1947. But the interesting thing is that until the Muslims immigrated, the Muslims formed the majority of Yerevan. Armenians became only majority in Yerevan after, not majority, almost in parity. After this, that doesn't mean Armenians were not there. Because of many wars that had happened, Armenians had escaped to Georgia. Some had gone to the Karabakh area, but most of them had gone to Georgia during all those terrible wars before 1828, had gone into the area. And that's why Tiflis had such a large Armenian population. Does that answer you?
Oh, yes, very much. More than I expected.
Thank you. Yes.
Reprint version
that got published
in 1991
and sent to the universities. Is there any policy at the universities where, if scholars like you write and prove that this reprint is falsified, that they would put it out? No. No. Because it's impossible. If they start censoring every book, we could. The only way one could do it is if an academic of that university, if a professor of that university goes around and saying, you know, this is wrong, but most of them. Universities, first, no, the good thing of it is that today's students don't read at all. They don't read at all. I have students. I just finished one of their papers. I finished grading the papers. If you see the quality of English, and I'm a foreigner, I came to this country when I was 21. If I'm correcting papers and giving D's and F's to people who were born here, you have no idea of the sentences. You have no idea of the way they are writing. Nobody cares. But they all have cell phones. They all have this little stuff that they text each other. And they all have very good cars. And most of it is because the parents, I'm sorry to say, you, we have, including myself, we have spoiled our children because we didn't have anything. We want to make sure they have everything. Yeah, but having everything makes them stupid.
So illiteracy is our best hope? For
illiteracy is already our best hope. Why do you think we elected Bush? Yes. I mean, not once, but twice. Yes.
What is being done to
counter this effort of these Azeri translations by sending your publication?
No, we can't send it because somebody has to pay for it.
Well, that's what I'm asking.
Well, but I have no, I can't go around telling people, buy my book and send it to the library. I mean, whoever wants to. The problem is we only printed this in 1,000 copies. And it's selling, but it's selling among scholars. You know, it's tough. All major universities got a copy. I mean, that's the automatically order, because this is part of the Armenian series. And this is book number 15 of the Armenian series. So once the major library, Harvard has it, Boston College has it, Tufts, I don't know. But all the others, the major universities, UCLA, Berkeley, etc., Princeton has it, Yale has it, because I check. There's a way you can check to see who has it. They automatically get all the Armenian series that come out. But public libraries, even if you send it to them, the Azeris send it to public libraries. Who in the public libraries reads Azeri or Russian? I mean, who really is going to pick that book up? It's just to make themselves happy. You know, you can't fight it. I mean, you can't. The main thing is this is only good in case one day we need documentation to resolve the conflict, as Moorad used to say. This will give you some historic legitimacy. Although in the long run, it's tanks, airplanes, and machine guns that will determine who has it, not books. I mean, the simple example is Israel. You can have any example you want. Israel attacks, takes, and nobody says anything. It's the same thing here. Okay, there's nothing wrong. Once you have it, then you negotiate. My opinion is they do very well. They should take a lot of extra, and then we'll negotiate and give things we don't want back. You know, like Gaza. Take Gaza. You know, who wants Gaza? Yeah.
Something with my understanding of the population of that area between, let's say, 1500 and 1900, is it a mixture, a mosaic in a way, of Armenians, Arabs, Persians, and so forth, where Yugoslavia was?
Exactly. It was mixture. Except when you look at the 1823 survey, the mountain areas, what's called Nagorno-Karabagh, even then had an Armenian majority. The Muslims, Kurds, and others were in the lowlands. Armenians always had a majority in the mountains.
All right. Part two question in a moment. Majority means 51% or 99%?
No, more. Armenians, well.
Or we don't know.
We don't know exactly. I have to go look at this survey. The survey is 400 pages long. I have to translate this, analyze it. But majority could be 60%. But they were. But you are right. Very much like Yugoslavia. There are villages next to each other. One village is Armenian village. Next to it, I've read a few pages of this survey. Right next to it, there's a Tatar village. But the Tatar village is 100% Tatar. The Armenian village is 100% Armenian. They don't mix. It's the same it was in the Ottoman Empire before the genocide.
Exactly.
Armenian villages were Armenian villages. There could be a Kurdish group down the river. But Armenians were Armenians. They did not mix that way.
What does it mean to be Armenian in Karabakh or in that area in 1750? Keep in mind, there's no republic that has happened. The kingdoms are gone.
Only Christianity. Only that. They didn't even speak Armenian well. Many of them spoke Persian. Many of them spoke half Persian words. No, it's only Christianity. That's the only difference. And of course, they married each other. Christians have to marry Christians.
So basically, that's what Armenian Jews meant.
Very little modern nationalism, no. They did have that 10,000-man army, mainly because they wanted Peter to come as Christian Russians to save them from Muslim rule. Not that they wanted an Armenian flag. That didn't exist.
All right. Now, the medics,
good question.
The medics.
Yes.
If Armenian Jews was one village at a time, it sounds like the medics had something a little bit bigger. Or did they, the medics, that is, had no vision of Armenianship as much as they had a vision of their own prince.
Precisely. You are right the second. The Meliks were collecting taxes for themselves. That's the main thing. Yeah, there was no such thing as... you are bringing modern national feelings to something that did not exist. It's the same problem we have with Tigran the Great. I don't know if you were here when I gave a lecture on Tigran the Great on my book that I translated. Many of us feel that Tigran, of course, we should be proud. He was the only great king we had, although for only 20-some years, their empire was there. It was good. But when you study the sources, Tigran spoke Greek and Persian. He was a potentate of the time, a semi-dictator at the time. He killed three of his own boys. You know, so he had more than one wife. You have this, because this was before Jesus, 100 years. So we have this idea of this nice Tigran, an Armenian king with a nice Armenian wife, and they have shish kebab. You know, he was a despot, he had a harem, he had a number of, he had a harem, like an Iranian ruler. He was an Eastern Asiatic potentate, an important emperor. Okay, he would cut heads off, but he had to be that way because all the kings of the time were that way in Asia. So suddenly to make Tigran Christian 100 years before Jesus was born, and I give him one wife, and give him a nice man, and he's pure, that would be stupid. What made him? He was the king of Armenia. There was a country, Armenia, but he was not waking up in the morning worrying about Armenian. He was worrying about his empire. His empire had an Armenian minority. His empire went all the way to Palestine. He had Arabs, he had Greeks, he had Persians, he had Cappadocians. Armenians were one part of his empire. What was left after it was all taken away from him was Armenia. That was left at the end. Okay? Now, I'm not saying he was not Armenian. But he was not Armenian the way you think today.
That's right.
The president of Armenia. You understand? That's the difference. Of course he was Armenian. But the Persians didn't feel themselves as Parthians either. They were the emperors of a big empire. It's like president of the United States. You really, we have a multinational country here. We can't say, I'm this, I'm that. In fact, we've gone even further. We've even banned religion. We can't celebrate Christmas in high schools. You're not allowed to celebrate Christmas in high school. Yeah, it's winter vacation, something. It's exactly what the Soviets did. Father Frost. Father Frost. We're approaching the Soviet system. We learned a lot. We can't say BC AD anymore. The Soviets created that. Right after revolution, the Soviets did. Before our era, after our era. The Soviets began the thing, and now we are rich there. It's wonderful. We're doing everything the Soviets did. And we were enemies, which was stupid. Why were we enemies? We're following almost in every other, as far as religion goes, we're doing exactly what they did. Yeah.
I hate to cut off a good digression, but I have a question. It's kind of related to what Linda asked before. You can't take books out of a library. Right? We agree on that much. You can publish your book, which goes through it point by point and demonstrates what's happened. But nonetheless, at the end of the day, what you're left with, if people want to construe it as that, is a controversy.
Yes.
And often it seems that that's sufficient, right? Well, Bournoutian says this, Bunyatov says that, some other scholar says that. It's a controversy. We can't really say what.
That's exactly what they do about the genocide.
Exactly.
It's a controversy. But that's, I know, but it's a very, see, since I have written the book, I cannot go around telling people what to do with it. I write about it as much as I can when I speak somewhere or on radio occasionally or etc. I talk about that this is wrong, they shouldn't do it. I even wrote a small article in the Chronicle of Higher Ed. People know that these things are happening, but there are only a few scholars. The general public is really not that much. We have a lot of other problems now, especially now. The stock market collapsed 800 points, now 400 points, went to 800 points. There are no jobs, this. The oil is leaking there, somebody is blowing Times Square. People are up to here with headaches. And now suddenly the American population who is new to that even doesn't know where Karabagh is. 90% of my students don't know the map. I give them a map exam, 60% of the class gets an F. they don't know where Ireland is. I'm not talking about Luxembourg, Andorra, Liechtenstein, San Marino, the difficult part. They don't know Ireland. They don't know the 50 United States except the very big ones. I'm not joking. Okay, these are college kids. You don't believe me, give you a test one day to anybody. They don't know it.
California students were interviewed by
yeah.
Jay Leno. They didn't know whether we were North America
or South America. They don't know the Civil War. They don't know who the Civil War was about, what it was and who fought whom. Okay?
But these are going to be teachers, by the way.
They are going to be teachers. That's why I failed them. Yes.
A great patriot and a great contributor to the future of Armenia. I am so glad that this is honoring him. I'm very interested, and as you know, he was someone that was extremely committed to mediation and to people getting along at the dialogue and to promoting those skills with people. And I'm curious, you made one statement which I find very interesting. You said, we bring modern national feelings to something that did not exist. And I'm curious, when you say modern national feelings, how do you feel that's going to project into the future? And what value that has for peace and for stability in the region versus, and how those feelings of nationalism that perhaps exist in extremis because we feel our nation is so often under stress.
It's a very good question, but before we can sit down and have those negotiations, the side, in case of Turkey, has to admit that there was a genocide. You cannot sit down to negotiation when the other side said it never happened.
Yeah.
See, that's the moment they say it happened, and the moment the Azeri say, because now the Azeri books, Armenia doesn't do that. Armenian books printed in Yerevan right now, when you look at the maps, because they have maps, it says the Khanate of the books printed in Azerbaijan do not mention Armenia on their maps. Okay, we don't exist. So you can't negotiate with somebody that says you don't exist. First, they have to say you exist. Second, they have to understand that it is to stop. Armenians are not falsifying history. No Armenian historian is Yerevan is changing primary sources. Now, they might write nationalistic stuff, that's fine. But altering primary documents? Armenians have never done that. Well, we don't need to do it because we have the history. Once they stop falsifying, then yes, I agree exactly what Moorad said. Conflict resolution is wonderful. It's better to have conflict resolution than shooting each other with tanks, because that's not going to answer it. I agree. And in the long run, we're going to lose, because Armenia is small, Azerbaijan is very large, and they have the oil, and it will just a matter of time that we will probably have a hard time defending Karabakh. So I agree with you. I want the conflict resolution. But it's impossible to talk with somebody when they are not even interested in talking. They want to say, give us Karabakh back, give everything back, we have to go back to the original borders, and then we will talk. It's not going to work. It may work if it comes to the point that Armenians have no chance, and then it will go back. It doesn't, I mean, there's not, this is just academics. As I said, in the long run, it's diplomats and the army that will sit down and decide who is what, and all of this will not make any sense.
Just a quick clarification. When do you think this modern national feeling came into play the most?
But that's when it came with everybody else, the same national feelings that started among the Bulgarians, the Romanians, after the French Revolution.
17.
Historians look at nationalism following French Revolution and Napoleon. That's what nationalism begins. Because you see, before that, there was no national flag. You fought for the flag of the church or the pope or the flag of the king. The fleur de lis was not the flag of France. It was the flag of the Bourbons, or the flag of the king, or the flag of the Louis, a flag of Richard, etc., etc., etc. After that, countries began having flags, colors. France got the tricolor, Russia got the same tricolor in reverse, Russian colors. You know, the United States got the same red, white, and blue, its other versions. But so we got the national flag, and we all got national anthems. There were no national anthems. One of the earliest is Marseillaise, which suddenly became national anthems are there to rally the people. Have you ever heard of a national anthem, even from a small country, that says, we're stupid, small, and weak country? Even a puny little country? All national anthems glorify death, and to die for your country becomes honorable. Before, to die for the church. But now, to die for your country, you're a hero. And they developed medals. Most of the medals started in the late 1700s. And now we're adding medals. Okay? So they give you medals to honor you. They call you a hero. They call you a martyr, etc. They fold the flag for you and to give it to the mother. This is all new. By new meaning 200 some years old. Nationalism did not exist to this extent. So you die for your country, you etc., 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 etc. And this is known as... And the history books. All the history became mandatory in the curriculum. Germans taught their history their way. France taught their history their way. We are not very good either in high school. We have forgotten that we stole Texas, we stole California, we stole everything from the Mexicans. We don't talk about that. And if Texas, if you even go to Alamo and say you stole this from the Mexicans, they'll shoot you. That's nationalism. We wave flags like no other country. The only country that flies the more flags than we are Turkey. If you go to Turkey, they have it hanging from every apartment. US and Turkey are the biggest flag wavers. Yes?
In the case of many of the, the generals within the Russian army and then the Soviet army were from Karabakh.
Yes, that's why they did so well.
Yeah. Now, who were some of these?
They were all, many of them were meliks, or children of meliks, or children of landowners.
Like Melikov,
and there are many others. There's a whole group of them that all, not just in the army of the 19th century, but even in the 20th century, Armenians had more officers under communist army than the Azeri. The Muslims generally were relegated to work battalions in the Soviet army. The officer corps Armenians did well, and that's why they did so well in the Battle of Karabakh.
That's right.
That's very, very important to realize. And we have a person in Karabakh, the bishop in charge of Ganzasar. It's a fantastic man. Very, very nice. Yeah, very nice. Parker Serpas.
But you want to finish it?
I'm not the ones, they're asking questions. I have nothing to do with
one more.
To kind of spin off of that from earlier, at the beginning of your talk, you had said that Mr. Mooradian was a great patriot but not a nationalist. So could you define what you mean by patriot and nationalist? And also, the second question is, the Armenians, you said that they were, they kept their identity because of Christianity, but what kept them from assimilating with Assyrians or Greeks or Georgians?
The Georgians broke away from the Armenian church in 609. Well, you want the whole history of the Council of Chalcedon? That's another day. I'll tell you how it all happened. It started with the Council of Chalcedon. It's a little bit too long. But the difference between nationalist and patriot, an extreme nationalist is somebody who does not see reason. That's exactly what the Turks and the Azeris are. Extreme nationalism. They're blind to logic. A patriot is not an extreme nationalist. A patriot can sit down. Yes, he wants to negotiate a better deal for his country, but he's not blind. That's the difference. Extreme nationalism is very dangerous in any group.
What you just said is a nationalistic statement.
Yes.
Not all Turks
I know. You're right. I'm sorry. You're absolutely right. Most Turks are. Very good point, Father. Okay, he's pushing me. It's not my fault.
It's my fault. I want to thank George for another excellent, interesting, and exciting talk. And I want to thank the extended Mooradian clan for being here and for honoring us with their presence, and we really appreciate it. Please stick around. There are refreshments. The bookstore is open. You can buy Professor Bournoutian's book and bring it to the library of your choice. Or keep it for your own library. That's okay, too. Buy a couple copies. We'll be happy with that. Thanks for coming, and we'll see you next time. Okay, you don't have to keep that.
I want to remind you about the Russian writer. Yeah. He was a great writer.